welcome to the Fantasy Show. Game Week 30 has only just finished, but Game Week 31 is right around the corner. So we thought we'd bring you a little bonus episode ahead of the midweek games. And joining us today is the FPL family, Sam and Lee Bonfield. Sam, first of all, you wild carded in Game Week 30. How did that go?
Yeah, it's always nice to get a green arrow out of a wild card, isn't it? Yeah. So not exactly the huge green I was hoping for, but a little green. And we start building from here.
Yeah. And Lee, you're 55 points now ahead of Sam.
Yes.
Got the Bonfield Cup in the bag.
Mind games have begun already in the lead up to the crescendo of the season. Loads of football still to go, Liv. So, no, it's not done and dusted.
No, nowhere near. It's not what he said in rehearsals. He was very confident in rehearsals. Okay, well, let's take a quick look then at the midweek fixtures for Game Week 31. We've got five matches on Tuesday night with Newcastle and Tottenham both in action. On Wednesday, we've got Arsenal at home to Luton and Man City at home to Aston Villa. Then Game Week 31 concludes on Thursday night with Liverpool against Sheffield United and Chelsea versus Man United. So here is your first reminder. The deadline is on Tuesday at 6 p.m. UK time. Do not forget to set your teams. But first, we're going to start things off today with a look at a couple of premium midfielders. We have a Spurs fan and a Liverpool fan in the building today. So it's only fair we do a Son Heung-min versus Mo Salah. Lee, you didn't have Salah going into this game week. Neither did I. We got away with one a little bit, didn't we? Oh, non-Salah owners.
Massively. I think he had 12 shots at the weekend, which was the most he's ever had in a Premier League game. So obviously, I had my Liverpool hat on during the game. So when he scored, I was obviously cheering, sat back down and thought, that's really going to hurt me in FPL. But when the dust had settled after the game, I was like, massively got away with one not owning Salah this week.
Sam, your face doesn't look too happy with that. Are you fuming?
Honestly, it was one of those matches where obviously I'm sat in the living room next to Lee watching this thinking, how is that 55 points not like 20 points? Because he should have absolutely hauled. And this was the perfect moment to own Salah when his ownership was low, have a really nice green arrow on the back of it. I can't help but feel it was an opportunity missed.
Going to be
this week.
Super popular now, isn't it? Super popular.
Yeah, I feel like everyone's going to go for him now. In terms of Son versus Salah, then, let's have a look at their seasons. Let's compare them both. Because, Lee, they're actually, when you look at it, they're having very similar seasons, aren't they?
Yeah, pretty good. Look at the stats. They're pretty close there. Look at the XG, though. Son massively overachieving his XG. But we've seen that in previous seasons. We know how clinical he can be in front of goal. He doesn't need a load of XG to rack up the goals. So they are having a very, very similar season. Even in FPL points, they're only three in it. So I know we're having a Salah versus Son debate here, but for sure there's part of that debate where you could go for both, right?
Yeah, it could be a Salah and Son, especially if you're on a wild card. Sam, obviously Son is way cheaper than Salah. Could that sway people's thinking if they can't afford Mo Salah?
Oh, I think it will be a very brave FPL manager who goes without Mo Salah, particularly in the coming weeks with Liverpool doubling in game week 34. I think you're going to want to have space for him. So if that means that you have to sacrifice Son in order to be able to have Salah, then I think that's the way I'd play it, because Spurs doubles are going to come later on in the season. So if you wanted to, you could always swap it over at that point.
You mentioned the fixtures. Let's have a look then at Son's and Salah's fixtures, because you mentioned the Liverpool double in 34. But actually, even just looking at those two, Sheffield United and Crystal Palace in 31 and 33, surely you can't go without Salah, Lee, for those two games.
I think you know, we rarely use the word essential, don't we, in FPL? We don't like using it, but look at that run. And you've only got to watch the highlights from Game Week 30 and to know that you're going to need Mo for that fixture run. So, yeah, listen, Son can do it against any of those sides, right? Obviously, Game Week 34 is the blank. You're going to probably bench him if you've got him. Mm-hmm. But even coming out of the blank, 35, 36, some difficult-looking fixtures. So I'm with Sam. I think if you need to make a sacrifice to get Mo, then Son is an OK one to make. But it's a tough decision, really, really tough.
When you looked at those fixtures, even the Manchester United away fixture for Salah, if you've watched Brentford, Man United, and the amount of chances that Brentford created, surely for all of those fixtures, even including that Manchester United one, would be perfect for Mo Salah.
I think when you're in a title race, as Liverpool are, and it's a really tight title race that you don't really know how it's going to go, as an FPL manager, that is exactly what we want, isn't it? We want our big clubs all still in the hunt, because there's that extra drive, that extra determination. And we saw at the weekend with Salah, he wasn't afraid to have shots constantly. Now, the only negative for us as FPL manager is the more shots he has, if he doesn't score them, he drops out of the bonus points, which is what we saw at the weekend. So just having seven for him was a little bit frustrating. But yeah, I think with the fixtures the way they are, you have to own him.
Yeah.
And Lee, obviously, it was his first Premier League start since New Year's Day. Hamstring injury? What hamstring injury? Because he looked as fit as anything, didn't he?
You know what? We had this conversation, didn't we, before the game, and I'm saying, well, it's his first start. I kind of maybe expect him to come off the bench for a game like Brighton at home. But we saw, particularly in the second half, I think it was a breakaway from a Brighton corner. I think Luis Diaz was kind of counter-attacking and Salah was bombing up there on the left-hand side, up with him. Mm. And actually, the finish wasn't there. It's another one of the Salah wasted chances, right? Yeah. And then, you know, a fully fit Salah maybe takes that chance. But there was no, you know, at the end of that run, I was like, his hamstring is fine. He was a full throttle heading up with Diaz.
With Son then, we're probably sat here wondering, you were at the game, Sam, weren't you? How he didn't get more points. The shot that hit both posts, he did obviously get his goal in the end.
Yeah, and again, I sat there at one point with my head in my hands, kind of going, how have you not hauled for me here? Yeah, it was an opportunity lost again with him because you felt like there could have been a big double-digit haul out of him. In the end, he did pick up all three bonus points, but should have had so much more. He, for me, is a player that I think, if you can find a way to build him into your wildcard team with Salah, with Saka, with Haaland, will be a nice differential because a lot of people will have to make that sacrifice. If you can hold him, you're kind of setting yourself up really nicely for the week
to
come.
Do you think he goes back out left now, though? Richarlison getting a few minutes last couple of game weeks. I'd expect him maybe to come back in and play nine. Not saying that makes Son a bad asset, but out left, we've seen him in previous seasons and previously this season not be quite as effective FPL-wise.
I mean, possibly. I think the Richarlison coming back into the system does make a difference. But what we aren't seeing is Son going back on the touchline wide as we were in seasons gone by. He's still kind of coming in and that's important and would still have penalties, I would expect. So for me, I think regardless of whether Richarlison's there, he's still important.
One word answer. If you had Son and you didn't have Salah, would you be selling Son for Salah?
Yes, I would.
Yeah, I would too.
There you go. There is your answer. They would be selling Son for Salah. Okay, right. Now time to focus our attention on the forwards. Right, the most transferred out player this week is Ollie Watkins after he went off injured at halftime against Wolves, which means that a lot of people are now on the lookout for a new forward. So we've picked out the four most popular transfers in. You've got Darwin Nunez, Alexander Isak, Rodrigo Muniz and Dominic Solanke to try and work out who is the best option here. Right, first of all, let's start with Darwin Nunez, Lee. You're a Liverpool fan. If you know what you're going to get with Darwin, especially with those fixtures...
Yes.
Is he a good option? We know he's going to be entertaining.
For sure he's a good option, right? I mean, you're right. He's a little bit wasteful, and we've seen that in previous game weeks so far this season. But he added a different dimension to his game against Brighton and has done in recent weeks. So he kept Lewis Dunk and the Brighton centre-halves really engaged, and he was kind of in and around them the whole time, which led to Diaz and Salah getting a bit more time and space, and we saw how effective they were in that game. But that doesn't mean that Nunez is a bad pick. I expect him against Sheffield United. I think he's going to start. I think he is. I mean, Cody Gakpo come on for a few minutes, didn't he?
You don't sound too confident.
Well, I'm not. Because he played the majority of that game. Yeah. And we've got a quick turnaround now for the next game. Cody Gakpo sitting there can play there. So I wouldn't be 100% sure, but I'm sure enough that he's a good pick for this week.
Would you agree, Sam? Even though there might be a tiny question mark on whether he starts?
I just think that he's one of those players, isn't he? And we've seen in previous game weeks this season when he has come off the bench, he's still going to get himself in the right positions and he's still going to create chances. And to be honest, if he doesn't start in the game against Sheffield United, I would expect that facing a tired Sheffield United for the last half an hour of a match could be a really positive thing for him as well. So, yeah, for me, I still think that even with a minute potential risk, he's a really good pick.
OK, what about Alexander Isak then? 15, 8 and 6 in his last three game weeks. So could he be an option? He looks like he's playing games and he's getting fitter. Doesn't look like he's perhaps as many injury doubts now.
That's always been the problem, hasn't it? Is that we've always had this risk of either rotation with Callum Wilson or the risk of a repeat injury. We've never had the consistency from him. Touch wood at the moment, we seem to be getting that. Now, the only thing that puts me off Isak, and it's only for midweek, is the lack of Anthony Gordon. Mm. Because obviously the red card means he's suspended for that game against Everton. I do worry a little bit that that means there'll be less creativity for Isak. Mm. Because Anthony Gordon is the sort of player that will naturally create opportunities. And their partnership has been lovely in the last couple of games. Mm. With Harvey Barnes, he's a little bit more selfish in his approach and will take the shots himself potentially rather than passing. But I think longer term, Isak is a nice pick. It's just that his double won't be till later. And will he still be fit? Will he still be firing by the time we hit sort of game week 36, 37?
That Everton at home fixture, though, that's a nice fixture, isn't it, Lee?
It's a great fixture. And I hear what you're saying about Anthony Gordon. He likes to win a penalty. So tricky in the box. He's great for touches in the box, Gordon. So every time they win a penalty, Isak steps up and takes it. I think while Callum Wilson is out, and I think he's out for probably a foreseeable, I really like him as a pick, Isak. He hasn't got the double, I don't think, in game week 34. Mm. But outside of that, he will have doubles later on. So I think he's a really nice pick.
Now, Rodrigo Muniz is the only player on this list that doesn't have a double at any point from now until the end of the season. But, Sam, some form he is in. That goal he scored against Sheffield United, he's been brilliant.
It's madness. 8-8 and an assist in that time as well. And it's not like he's been playing against, you know, weaker opposition. Yeah. Some of those goals came against Spurs, which did upset me during game week 29. But he is just offering such phenomenal value for money. When you're looking at that front line, we've just had a whole conversation about Salah and Son and how you afford to have them both in their team.
How.
This is how, because he enables you to save like 2 million, 3 million nearly on Dom Solanke. You know, you're saving 2.5 million there. Yeah. That 2.5 million buys you some back into your team. I just think he's invaluable. Plus, at that price point, when he does have a difficult fixture or in the double game week where you want to play your doubling players, you'll be happy to bench.
He's only 8% owned as well, so a real differential. And he's so, like Sam says, he's so cheap.
It's crazy. I mean, we've got loads of... We reel off all the stats you want, but when you score a scissor kick like that to draw the game in the sort of final moments of the game, that, for me, just screams confidence.
Yeah.
8-8, bang in form. It wasn't quite... Didn't quite have the form coming into the Premier League, did he, at previous clubs, but he's found his feet now at Fulham, and that goal just screamed confidence for me. I think he's a brilliant selection.
OK, and a quick word on Dominic Solanke, who is the most owned out of these, but he scored his 16th Premier League goal on the weekend. So he's still a brilliant option. And a lot of people, like we say, have already got him, haven't they?
Yeah, I mean, he was my sacrifice on my wild card. And I didn't really want to do it, given that he's got a double in 34. But the only way to make the budget work was to not have him and to have Muniz instead. So I made that decision. When Dom Solanke scored at the weekend, I was like, oh. And then actually, we got the equaliser anyway from Muniz, so it worked out in the end. But I do think going into 34, you're probably going to want to have Solanke.
Yeah, let's have a look then at just the stats comparing these four strikers. Because the one thing that stands out there, Lee, is Rodrigo Muniz, 100% big chances converted.
Yeah, what narrative would you like? Is it that he's super clinical, or has he been kind of just, you know, a bit lucky to have the chances that he's had? But I don't know. Listen, you can't argue with that 100%. Yeah. It's interesting that Nunes, actually, despite racking up more XG than the other, significantly more XG, low chance conversion. So there's the narrative that we want, isn't it? You know, if he can be a bit more clinical, what an FPL asset he can be. And I still think he's the pick to have this week.
It's a big if, isn't it?
It is a big if.
Right, OK. I'm going to get you to rank 1 to 4, just the names, on who you'd be going for from best to worst, who you'd be transferring in. Sam, you go first.
Spoiler alert for later, but I've bought in Darwin this week, so I'll pop him up top. Nunez came on wildcard, and I just think at his price point, you can't get much better than that. So he's in next. Because Solanke has the double before Isak, Solanke next, and then Isak last, but it's only on the doubles.
Names only, Lee.
Double game week is first. Darwin, Solanke, Isak, Muniz.
Perfect. That is exactly what we wanted. OK, right, time for a quick break now. But in part two, we'll be taking a look at Sam and Lee's teams. And of course, we'll work out who's a captain. It's a big dilemma this week. We'll see you very soon. Right, in case you missed the launch of FPL Challenge at the weekend, there's still plenty of time to get a team entered as it's a weekly competition. You can read the rules at fplchallenge.premierleague.com. And the challenge this week is forwards get double points. Now, we've asked Sam and Lee to share their FPL Challenge teams with us. Sam, we'll start with you. Talk me through your FPL Challenge team this week.
Do you know what? This challenge was difficult because actually there's so many teams with nice fixtures in the midfielders that I was like, I haven't got much budget left. So I did have to go with Muniz still up top, even though I potentially, in a forwards get double the points, would have liked to have had maybe somebody a bit more expensive, but he's in fantastic form. And I've kind of doubled him up with Haaland, who I think everybody will have, and then Darwin. I've handed Darwin the armband because, of course, double points for forwards.
You've got quadruple Darwin.
So quadruple Darwin against Sheffield United feels a bit lovely. And then I filled my team up with teams that I think are going to do well. So Liverpool, nice fixture. Arsenal, great fixture. Mostly gone there. Couldn't bring myself to not have Cole Palmer because he just feels like he'll punish me if I don't. And then Son, of course, even though I said I'd sell him earlier, which was almost sacrilege, he's back in for challenge.
We were saying, Darwin's your captain, quadruple zero, still zero, Sam.
No, but let's hope that that doesn't happen, Liv. Let's hope we get double-digit haul from Darwin and, yeah, a riot.
And you've gone triple up on Arsenal at the back as well, at home to Luton.
Yeah, it kind of makes sense, doesn't it? I benched my Arsenal defenders this week and it hurt for that clean sheet. Yeah. So I think in challenge, an opportunity to target the very best defence in the league against one of the worst attacking sides.
Yeah. Right, Lee, let's have a look at yours then. Talk me through your team.
Well, this game mode is so fun, isn't it? I've been dreaming for years about quadruple Darwin Núñez. And finally, here we are. We've got the opportunity to get four times the points for Darwin Núñez. A lot of my FPL, you know, my actual FPL team bias is kind of sneaking in a little bit, I think, still. So I've gone with Palmer, same as you, yeah. Sam. I've stuck with the teams that I think are going to do well this weekend. You know, Liverpool at home, Arsenal at home, Palmer sneaked in there, as we said before, Solanke. Tried to be a little bit different with Havertz rather than go for sort of an Odegaard in midfield. But, yeah, I disagree with what you said at the beginning. I think it's quite easy to pick a team here because you can have five from any team, right?
It's the budget that's restricted
this
week.
That's
true. Because unlike last week, where we could spend whatever we wanted, this week we're limited back to 100 million. And that's what I found difficult, is finding players that fit us within that 100 million.
Yes.
Why Kai Havertz?
I just think the way that he's playing in that Arsenal team right now, perhaps it wasn't quite right for the City game. Perhaps his way of playing wasn't quite right. But he's a very physical player. I think he gives such physical presence up front. And we know what you're going to get with Luton. You're going to get physicality. So I think Arteta will drop him in. I think he'll do well.
We shall see, won't we? OK, let's round up some of the other hot topics then ahead of Game Week 31. OK, so we're going to do a quick-fire roundup of a few players ahead of Game Week 31. Now, we spoke Liverpool a lot, but we haven't spoken about this man, Luis Diaz. If you don't want or you can't get Darwin Núñez, is Luis Diaz a brilliant option? He was very, very good and very effective against Brighton.
Very good, wasn't he? Very good. And I think Darwin being there, as I said earlier on in the show, I think it really benefited. The work that he did benefited the two wide players. I don't want to mention Cody Gakpo again and rotation and everything else, but Luis Diaz is one of those very naturally fit players. So I expect him to play against Sheffield United. Really good pick. I wouldn't have him without Salah. I'd absolutely be prioritising Salah and Diaz alongside him if you want him.
The problem is there's so many good midfielders to pick from, isn't there, Sam?
True. Yeah, and I think that's the trouble, isn't it? Darwin's great because he takes a forward slot rather than one of the really important midfielder slots. And particularly when you've already got Salah in there, maybe you don't want the double up. But Luis Diaz would be a great differential. Mm. He'd be a really nice option.
And what about maybe Harvey Barnes scored two goals off the bench, only 6.2 million, a nice fixture at Everton at home?
Yeah, and talking about differentials, 1% owned Harvey Barnes. So coming into that team, would expect him to start, particularly with Anthony Gordon suspended. They're coming up against an Everton team who haven't won since game week 17, and they are in such poor form right now. 7 losses, 5 defeats in that time, and just the 2 clean sheets. I think there's an opportunity there for Harvey Barnes to go on a bit of a riot against Everton in midweek. And he is a long-term hold as well. If he can stay fit, then you could hold him more longer term towards the Newcastle double. So, yeah, great differential.
I'm going to ask you this, Sam, because I know you have Anthony Gordon. Are you holding? You're not going to sell him because obviously he's now suspended for one game.
Yeah, it's just the one game. Mm. So I will hold him. And I think, you know, I was a bit worried when I got him in anyway because he's quite close to the 10 yellow card suspension threshold. Mm. Hopefully this red card actually means we'll avoid him missing 2 games coming up in the future. But yeah, for me, if it was more than one game, I think I would have sold. But it's just unfortunate it's the game against Everton he's going to miss.
Yeah. What about Ben Brereton-Diaz then, Lee? 4 goals and 1 assist in his last 5 games.
Yeah, pretty good, right? And we're all kind of overlooking him because, again, we've spoken before about how precious those midfield slots are. So how do we fit in a Ben Brereton-Diaz? But listen, he was brilliant for Blackburn in the Championship. He's starting to find his feet, I think, in the Premier League. At 5 million, he's one of those that you could probably put as your fifth midfielder to afford the likes of Salah and Son and Haaland if you want all those guys. But for me, I still think I would go elsewhere with those 5 picks in midfield.
Got a double in 34, Burnley and Manchester United. If you're free hitting, could be an option.
Perfect on a free hit. He's averaging 7 points per match at the moment as well, which is a ridiculous total for somebody of 5 million. So if you are... people will be looking at players like Garnacho in that spot. Well, Garnacho hasn't got the same level of form that Brereton-Diaz does right now. Yeah. So if you are looking for a much cheaper than Gordon and Palmer asset, then I don't dislike him. And I think on free hit, he's perfect.
Phil Foden, Lee, is it safe to sell? Obviously, he came off after 60 minutes against Arsenal.
Yeah, a little bit ineffective, wasn't he? But then you could say the same about a lot of Manchester City's attacking play and the way that Arsenal kind of nullified them. I wouldn't say he's a priority sell for me. He's built up enough credit in the bank over this season in FPL to warrant holding him, I think. I've got him in my team. I'm going to be holding for a little while.
I might be selling.
Difficult one.
Yeah, I've not owned him yet.
Have you not?
No.
Oh, that's surprising.
Yeah, he's hurt me a lot this season.
Right, OK, now time to take a look at Sam and Lee's teams for Game Week 31. Right, it's time for some team reveals. Let's start off with Sam, then. You wildcarded last week. Mm-hmm. How's your team shaping up for Game Week 31?
Well, I was delighted with it, actually. Until then, the benching dramas happened. Obviously, Lascelles doing his ACL has just been a really difficult one. Anthony Gordon with his red card means that he's not going to play either. Gusto. The trouble with Gusto is he might be fine, but we're probably not going to know because Pochettino's press conference won't be until later in the week because Chelsea don't play until Thursday. So I'm probably just going to pop him to the bench. I have already made a transfer. The Ollie Watkins injury meant that I did my pre-planned transfer, which was Watkins to Darwin. And it feels like it's in quite a nice place. I might just have to change Lascelles out next week because I don't think I need a -4 for that.
No, absolutely. Right, OK. And what about you, Lee? Let's have a look at your team. Game Week 31.
Yeah, so the team's in reasonable shape, but I've taken a hit already. So my team had no Liverpool. We mentioned before my lack of Salah. Didn't have Darwin either. So Team Lee has taken a big risk this week and gone with Son out to Salah. It was the only way I could do it without really ripping up my team and kind of starting again, which is possible because I do have the wild card, but I want to hold it for Game Week 35 or at least after the double, maybe 34. So Salah and Darwin Nunez in, Watkins and Son out. And I'm going to wait and get behind the sofa when Spurs next play.
Yes. Why are you deciding to hold on that wild card and not use it yet?
I just think we've got so many double game weeks coming up later in the season, which are yet to be locked in. We've got a pretty good idea what it's going to look like. But once the big double game week 34 is out of the way, I'm going to want to switch quite a few players. And the wild card's perfect for that, for the running.
Sam, what about you? Obviously, you've used your wild card now. What's your long-term strategy from now until the end of the season?
I use my wildcard to mostly fill my team with players that I know I definitely want for 34. And at the point when I was wildcarding, I couldn't decide whether it was double Arsenal defence, double Arsenal attack, whether it was double Liverpool attack. Well, I knew I was going to end up there, but was there a defender that I felt was worthy of it? Because Connor Bradley and Kelleher don't look like they're going to keep their spots long term. So my long term plan is to treble up on those two teams. I just wanted to buy myself a little bit of time. And then there's picks in there, like the Chelsea picks, like the two Spurs picks, who are there for the long term. Same with Gordon, and Lascelles was there for that reason because they're going to double bit later. So yeah. I tried to kind of hedge my bets across both doubles.
Yeah. Right, time for one more question then, and it's the big one. Who to captain in Game Week 31? Right, we've picked out three main captain options this midweek, and it is a tricky one. The first one is Mohamed Salah at home to Sheffield United, Lee. Surely most managers are going to be putting the armband on him.
I think so. It wasn't that long ago, though, we would say, you know, Haaland at the Etihad, doesn't matter the opposition, perma-captain, all that sort of narrative from earlier on in the season. Just a little bit of dip in form for the Norwegian recently. So we are now looking at the Sakas and the Salahs. Listen, you know, he could have absolutely hauled, couldn't we? We spoke about it earlier on in the show. Very, very lucky as a non-Salah owner this week to get away with that. So, as Sam suggested, if you did bring him in for Game Week 30, that was the week you wanted him to go big, because we're all going to go there now, thinking 31.
Is it a worry, the amount of shots he had against Brighton and only scored one? Is it a worry going into this Sheffield United game?
You could look at it that way. So you could look at it and go, oh my goodness, weren't you wasteful? I don't, you know, maybe you're not going to be as clinical as you once have been. Personally, with Salah, I don't see it that way. I'm kind of like, if Salah's getting these opportunities and Liverpool are creating these opportunities, that only bodes well for them. They've got a title to go and try and win. And that's the thing with all three of those captaincy options, Salah, Saka, Haaland, all of them.
All good.
They're all needed to score goals for their teams if they're going to win the league. So I think they're all great picks, but Salah's my favourite.
If you don't have Salah, though, Bukayo Saka at home to Luton obviously came off what looked like maybe a little injury against Manchester City. Is there a question mark over whether he might start?
Potentially. Arteta said I think it was more fatigue. So, but then again, that's a worry given that we've got Champions League football the week after. So we've got three Premier League fixtures in a week, followed by Champions League, more Premier League, back to Champions League again. That is a lot of game time for actually all of these players because, you know, Salah's got it in the Europa League as well. So it is a bit of a risk, but I just don't think Arteta can afford to drop points. I think he'll start him and then bring him off if he can.
We've spoken about Haaland a little bit off form, obviously Villa at home. What about Darwin Nunez as a punt at home to Sheffield United?
Quadruple Darwin.
You've got it in the challenge, Lee. Get him in your FPL team as well. Not for me. Just based on what we saw at the weekend. Mo getting all the chances, getting really dangerous. Had a couple of weeks off, didn't he, over the international break? So didn't do a lot of travelling. Would have been preparing for the game weeks to come. So, a rejuvenated Mo, I think, nailed on for captaincy for me.
Yes, I think most people are going to go with Mo Salah. Lee, Sam, thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure. Remember, the deadline is on Tuesday at 6 p.m. UK time. The very best of luck, and we will see you next time. Bye-bye.